Okay. Hi, all of you, and the ones who are just waiting in the waiting room, let me make them enter. I'm admitting everybody. Very good evening to one and all, and a lot of people on the Facebook too, but I'll shortly put on the Facebook a very warm welcome to Mrs. Kavita here, who has agreed to do this show for us on the GreenEd platform. And everybody knows Ms. Kavita Lankesh, a very, very popular director. And a very popular scriptwriter, director, and there's a lot of other feathers in the cap, which of course Ms. Manju Chakravarti will be introducing us shortly. And Esther Nurana was introduced to me by Mr. Sandeep Malani, and thank you for doing the show for us. And this is a kind of a talk show which we do every Sunday at 5 p.m. And we have lots and lots of people who ask questions, and mostly the entrepreneurs, women who can be inspiration for many people who are looking at us today. Being women, I don't have a gender bias there, of course, with the women or men, but entrepreneurs can always be a kind of an inspiration to many people who want to be successful like you. So over to Manju Chakravarti to do this, take the talk further, and probably I can introduce you formally.
Yeah, thank you so much, Usha ma'am. Thank you so much, Esther. And thank you so much, Kavita ma'am, for joining us today. It's we are glad. And I mean, we don't have words, you know, to express our happiness today that you both have joined for this webinar.
Thank you so much.
And now let me just introduce. So welcome and a very good evening to all our participants. Participants who are shortly going to watch us on Telegram, Zoom, as well as on Facebook. So here we are back with our 8th episode to our Brewing Chats with edupreneurs, celebrities and entrepreneurs under the banner of the Green School Bangalore. So I, Manju Chakravarti, the school head of the Green School Bangalore, is back with a power-packed panelist again, sharing their insights and their success journey with us. Talking about TGSB, the Green School Bangalore, the Green School Bangalore system has always been favorable since its inception towards technological adaptability and innovation in the practices of pedagogy. With this in mind, we initiated the series of workshops and webinars, considering it is a way to collaborate and as well as a responsibility to share insights with the education and parent community. Every Sunday was dedicated to webinars to bring together parents, teachers, and several dignified educators from the fraternity across the country for a heart-to-heart talk show. Our weekly webinar and workshops include DIY and STEAM workshop for parents, children, and educators to know more about experiential and minds on learning on Tuesdays and Thursdays, the Art of Storytelling Katha Sangra workshops every Wednesday with renowned storytellers like Geeta Ramanujan, Sonal Chawda, and many more. Now, talking about this, one quote that comes to my mind with today's show is Walt Disney: all our dreams can come true if we have the courage to pursue them. And this time we are back with unique and most exciting talk show with awe-inspiring entrepreneurs, but of course, I mean, they are celebrities. So let's hear their entrepreneurial saga. The path to success lies in evolution, whether it is evolution of ideas, services and products or technology. An entrepreneur should have an open mind and eagerness to learn new things. It is imperative to understand that the only way to keep at the top is to keep on changing and evolving with time. Everybody wants to be a successful entrepreneur, but what makes them successful is a mystery of their mind. Accepting rejection or constructive criticism can go a long way in making an entrepreneur successful. Criticism shows what we or she is doing not properly or what or where the change is needed. So let's start with our, the panelists who have joined us today. Just before that, I mean, when we are, you know, today we are successful, I must say an actress, a director, and today is also the National Girl Child Day. So a very happy National Girl Child Day to each one of us who are here.
Thank you so much, Manju.
Okay. Usha ma'am, now I would request you to formally introduce our panelists for the evening.
It's a pleasure, because today the anchor, Ms. Priyanka Singh, is missing. I really miss her. She'd have done a wonderful job here. I have the pleasure to introduce Ms. Kavita Lankesh. We've talked on phone so many times. She's a wonderful woman. I find her as an inspiration for me as well. So Kavita Lankesh is an Indian film director. As we all know her, very popular screenwriter and lyricist, known for her work in Kannada cinema industry. She began as a documentary filmmaker before directing her first feature film, Diwari. Diwari, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly.
Deviri. It's Deviri.
Deviri.
Okay. Deviri.
Deviri, a movie based on a short story by Ms. Lankesh, saw her debut as a director, and she won several state, national, and international awards, including the International Critics Award and the National Debut Director Award for Kavita Lankesh. That's really great, Ms. Kavita. In several prestigious film festivals, it has been showcased. She is considered to be one of the renowned filmmakers of the Kannada cinema. She has directed and produced more than 50 documentary informational films and more than 40 corporate films. Some of the films Kavita directed has won awards and accolades from critics. So Lankesh is the youngest daughter of the well-known Kannada writer and journalist P. Lankesh. Kavita holds a master in English literature from the Bangalore University and a diploma in advertising. Kavita started her film career with a documentary on children's nature camp. She has made films about Bannerghatta National Park in Bangalore, the Siddhi tribe, the Ninasam, Ninsam, is right?
Ninasam.
Organization. It's called as?
Ninasam. It's a very famous theater group.
Yes. A cultural organization that promotes the development of theater and films. Kavita Lankesh also runs a resort exclusively for children called Grameen Camp, which introduces school children for various traditional village games and lifestyles, as well educate about farming. A very warm welcome to you, Ms. Kavita Lankesh.
Thank you, Usha. Thank you so much.
Namaste to you. And of course, Esther Norana, thank you, Sandeep Ji, to have introduced her to us. I think she's a very dynamic lady as far as I've talked to her. Indian film actress and playback singer. That's fantastic. What a combination. Who is best known for her work in South Indian films. Her acting credits feature films in Telugu, Kannada, Konkani, Tamil, Hindi and Marathi film industries. Notable among the filmography are Bhimavaram Bullodu, Garam, then Meen Korambu, then Man Paniyum. Is it correct? Am I pronouncing it correct?
Yes.
And Nagarik.
Yes.
She's acted in more than 25 films in 8 languages till now. At the age of 14, she established her independent musical live show with the title Esther Show, which was an aid of Mangalore Diocesan Medical Relief Fund. Esther has always been a distinguished student academically and with her passion in acting. She went on to graduate with a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science and Psychology and is now an MA in Political Science at the University of Mumbai. That's great. She's trained in piano, Bharatanatyam, Carnatic singing, and guitar. Esther is the first artist in Dakshin Kannada district of Karnataka to have performed Ranga Paravesha in both Bharatanatyam and Carnatic singing. Her film Nacho Mia Kumpasar is set in a...
Nacho Mia Kumpasar.
Okay, Nacho Mia. It's called like that? Nacho Mia Kumpasar.
Nacho Mia Kumpasar. It's a Konkani film.
Okay, it's a Konkani film. It's set in 1960s and is a tribute to the unsung Konkani musicians of that era. At the 62nd National Film Awards, the film won 2 awards and a special mention. The film won the award for the best feature film in Konkani. The film also won Lebara Play Audience Choice Award for the best film at London Indian Film Festival 2015. So it was also included in the shortlist for 2016 Oscars. And that's fantastic news, which I was not aware of. And I think many of them who are listening to it were not aware of, but will be aware that such a beautiful film has gone till Oscars. I'm sure about it. There are many more Oscars waiting for you, Esther. And of course, Kavita has done great in film industry. So over to you, Ms. Manju Chakravarti.
Thank you so much.
And the moderator will ask you questions and probably our audience is all waiting eagerly to hear you.
Thank you so much, Usha ma'am, for that brief introduction. I mean, we got to know so many things. And now, I mean, I look forward for an insight, I mean, a much deeper insight. I mean, even our audiences will be ready with their questions about, you know, many of the things that they'll be listening today. So let me start with Kavita ma'am. So Kavita ma'am, I mean, while Usha ma'am was reading your profile and we came across, like, you know, you are a director, the most renowned director when it comes to documentaries. You are also a scriptwriter. You're also a lyricist. So talking about all this, you know, various roles you are playing, how do you manage it? And how did it come to you? Did it come to you one by one? Or was it all like, okay, no, right now, let me focus on filmmaking. Probably then sometime I look into being a lyricist. How does it work?
No, it doesn't work. See, I think always cinema itself, amalgamation of many, many kinds of art. You know, it's called writing. It's got literature. It's got, again, when you write songs, it's got literature in it. dance is there, it's an art form. And when you imagine a frame, for instance, when you're shooting, how what kind of frame you want or what kind of lighting you want, it's almost like a painting. So it's a whole lot of, mixture of many arts is what I would say cinema is. And I started off actually somehow because I was running an advertising agency. And it so happened at one point, one of the forest department, Karnataka Forest Department, asked me, would you like to make a documentary on our nature camp? You know, some children were going on a two-day trip to Banagatta National Park. And I said, okay, I would love to do it. So we took, at that time, it was just a VHS camera, you know, old style of camera, which doesn't even exist anymore. So we took that and I spent time with the children, shooting everything, shooting the activities. That I mean, they taught a lot about conservation of forest and how to deal with wildlife and things like that, the children. So I shot all that and I came back and made the script and voiceover and edited it. So then I loved the whole process of it, you know. So I said, it's fantastic. So after that, of course, I was in love with making documentaries, of course. But you don't have many kind of platforms to show documentary, or people don't give money to make documentaries, really. So I would do, what I would do was make a lot of corporate films. I would say, okay, take from the rich and, you know, give to the poor kind of thing. So I'd make a lot of corporate films for companies. And the money I made from that, I would keep some aside just to do documentaries on things I love, you know, on subjects I love. Like, for instance, I did one on folk singers of Karnataka, women folk singers of Karnataka. And the whole thought process was so beautiful, because when you go to the villages, some of the women know about 10,000 songs on their lips. It's in their mind. They know it by heart. And for each activity, they have a song. You know, when they're doing, when they're like grinding the ragi, they have a song. When they're in the farm, they have a song. Picking up the, you know, plowing the land, they have a song. Or when a baby is born, or when a baby matures, or when a girl goes off to her husband's house. So each part, they have a song. And I found it amazing. And I thought it was a treasure trove we should have. You know? So I shot that. But of course, after that documentaries, it was not a stepping stone, but it's something which I loved making was feature films, which I've done 10 so far, 10 feature films, and most of them have won awards. And also some of them have been super hits. So, I mean, awards itself is not enough. You should also have some rewards, I would say. So it's something, it's like a passion. You know, movies, even whether it's a hit or a flop, it doesn't matter. But there's always a story waiting to come out of you, waiting to be told. So this, I think, is the, you know, movies is a constant obsession and a passion. Yeah.
Wow, that's wonderful. I think, I mean, what I can take in a nutshell, what you have just expressed, that it was your interest, definitely. Yeah. And the moment you got into it, the passion kept on taking you, engaging you more.
Yes,
so that is what
absolutely. Yeah, it's a constant. I mean, anybody in the movie industry will tell you that you will always, because it's like a story writer with a pen.
Yeah.
You know, he'll always wonder whether nobody reads the story or not, doesn't matter. You will want to write the story because you're a writer. And the same with the filmmaker. I mean, of course, we do have a lot of platforms. I mean, some movies might not be seen by the local audience, but internationally they're seeing it.
Right.
Like that. So it's different set of audiences are there, you know, for every movie. As long
Absolutely.
As it's a movie.
I do have a question on this, but first I'll just move to Esther, put her a question, and then I'll come back, you know, in continuation of what you mentioned about you. So yeah, Esther, I mean, while I was going through your profile, you know, I was reading a lot and I could see that I think right from the age of 9, you are totally engaged with, you know, fine arts, visual arts and performing arts. And then when at the age of 14, you came up just now, Usha ma'am did mention about, you know, you had your own show, like you had your own band kind of thing. And you helped raising so much of funds for various reasons. So how did you manage? And then I come across that you have completed your BA, you have done your MA, and now you're a successful actress. I mean, who is working in so many, you know, different languages. I mean, so many movies. So how did you, I mean, how was the journey and what made you? Like, no, I should look forward. I should complete my studies also. I should work for this also.
Mm-hmm. The thing is, there was never a plan. Like, there was no foreseeing into a future or imagining that I'll be in such a place at such a time. There was no such plan. But it was always about following the heart. Right from the start, I think it has, it began not in my generation, but from my parents is what I can say, because I was born and brought up in Bahrain, in the Gulf country. And looking at my interests, my parents are music lovers and have been active in their years. Like when my mother was a teenager and in her college time and stuff like that, she has been very active musically and she has been on the stage. She has been an active sports person in her career. So she knew the importance of following one's heart and following one's passion and the importance of pursuing the dream. So when in Bahrain and when I was a very young child and I started showing interest in the same fields, I was interested in music, I was interested in dance. So she believed that if there is a talent, then it has to be nurtured, it has to be trained. Having a talent and not training it leaves it to be just a hobby. It remains being a hobby and not a career or not a profession or doesn't go too deep or intense into it. Like after a point, you find it just remains as a memory or as a part of your life in a very faded away form. So my mom understood and knew the importance of training, which is why she gave up her career in Bahrain, and she and I came down to India. That's where we started. That is where the journey began, where we started pursuing every interest and we took up every interest seriously. And she made sure that I was getting trained in the right place at the right time, in the right stream that I was showing interest in. And as and when that happened, like once I started to learn putting my heart into something I like, then it's just coming from there. I just liked music. I started to sing. But because I liked it and I learned from the right people at the right time, it grew in the right direction and I got the right opportunities. Again, my mother pushed me to make the best of it, every opportunity that came by, and that opportunity gave me more opportunities. So it was just a journey. One thing led to another. But the key mantra till date, like even now, I did not know. I had never heard of languages like Telugu. I had not watched many films in my life. Being an actor was never a dream as such. But being good at what I do was always a dream. I always wanted to be good, and I still strive on getting better every day in everything that I do. And that leads me to new paths and new career options and new industries and new languages. So that's how things happened. So I started with music. Eventually, that led me to dance. And as I was into the musical scenes, I was doing shows, I was active on stage. That led me to films. So one film led to another. So it's just a journey. And even now it's just a journey. I don't see myself. I don't draw a line and say, okay, this is where I want to be. I believe in God's plans and I just work hard on whatever is in my hands right now with all my heart.
Wow, that's so beautiful. I think Usha ma'am, today is the right day to have this talk show with both of them. Being, you know, this National Girl Child Day, they both have taken it so beautifully that how their parents, their family have, you know, motivated them that follow your dreams, follow your passion. So I think this is the best day to have you both on. I mean, thank you so much for sharing this insight. Now, again, I mean, the same thing, what Esther, I can, take from your, whatever you have expressed, that you had a passion.
Ravita always says that she loves to work with children rather than, you know, being in the, being a big star. I've always seen a quote in Indian Express and all that stuff. So she should talk about that with you. Later.
Absolutely. My next question is on the same lines, ma'am, that, you know, Esther, I mean, you just mentioned that when you had that interest, which you showed, you know, for performing arts and all, your mother identified it and she took that call that let's go back to India and, you know, take it forward. So continuing on the same lines, Esther, I'll put this question to Kavita ma'am, but you have to again, you know, add to this. So Kavita ma'am, I mean, I can see that in today's, I mean, of course, I mean, at school level itself, when, you know, that's the right place, I must say, wherein the interest gets, you know, developed, where a child is actually looking forward for so many avenues. And what happens is that at times, you know, initially that we restrict them that, okay, no, first academics. Okay, you have your subjects, you have your languages, you first need to deal with them. And then only if you have time, then you go for your, you know, other interest areas, might be the sports or any kind of art form or anything. How do you look to it? And what is the suggestion that you can, you know, give? Where should we make the changes? Of course, not at the college level, but at the school level, there is a big thing that we need to bring upon.
Yeah, I think in the school level, I think parents should understand that every child is going to have a lot of interest, as you said. And the academics will probably be the last, and only maybe some few handful of children will really like academics. Rest of them will have 100 other interests. And I think it's important that the parents recognize it and teach them, or as Esther said, take them to the, you know, any of the kind of like music or arts or sports, take them. And sometimes I also know it's very annoying because my daughter herself has probably shifted some 8 different courses through that. I mean, she tried basketball, she tried music, you know, it keeps happening. 2-3 months, they like something and then they say, no, it's boring. But it's fine. And until they find, like how we want to find our own path, you know, our journey. Sometimes we're going in one direction and the direction changes. And whether you like it or not, you might change it again. So like that, the children will have 100 different interests. And it's important that we teach them. And some of them will stick to one and, you know, all their life. Like maybe like Vishwanath Anand, for instance, who like chess, who's playing from young. If imagine if his mother had said, no, I don't want him to play chess, maybe something else. Or, you know, so it's important to know, to gauge the child's wishes and likes and dreams and make them follow. But at the same time, it's also important for them to give it up, you know. It's important that they give it up and say it's fine. Am I still
on? I also think not everyone is the same. They're not all the same. Like it, like how she said, every child is different. Everybody has their own calling. I have seen myself. When I was a kid, like how you people noticed as well, I was doing sangeet, I mean, Carnatic vocals. I was doing classical dancing. I was also good at academics. I was learning musical instruments as well. So looking at me, there were many people who used to tell their children or force. Even today, I see so many parents coming with their children and saying, you have to be like her. One person doesn't necessarily have to be like the other. You have to be like yourself. Being yourself is what makes you unique. So my parents never told me I had to be like someone else. If that was the case, I too would have been doing just one thing. It was in my capacity that I could grasp so many things. It happened to be that I could still manage with all the things. And that itself, see, that somewhere is a part of my personality. Back then, would have been dance, music, and academics. But today it is maybe 8 languages. I learn languages quickly. I get along with people easily. So it is a part of my characteristic. So that necessarily may not be another person's characteristic. Maybe that other person is good at focusing on just one thing and doing that one thing very well. So one person doesn't have to be like another person. They say, even when they say stars, I say like the sky is too big. Every star has its own place. That doesn't have to be just one shining in the middle of the sky. And it doesn't look good either. Absolutely. There has to be a big star. There has to be a small star. And every star is traveling in their own pace and is shining in its own right. And the sky has place for everyone.
Very true, Esther. I mean, that's. I mean,
on this note, Manju, on this note, I would like to say once I'd gone to a parent-teacher meeting kind of thing, and I would like to say this because
that's interesting. We are really eager to listen to
they told me, okay, not necessarily my child, my cousin, somebody. She's saying, you know, she's good in everything except math. I said, fine, what do you teach? She said, English. So I said, fine, but why are you teaching English and not math? She said, I'm good at English. So I said, it's the same thing with the child, you know. Not a teacher is not teaching all the languages or all the subjects. So of course you have dedicated, the teachers done all the subjects mediocrely and then become a master at one of the subjects. And that's exactly we should let the child be, I think, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what, I mean, you both have just correctly mentioned that parents have to just understand that every child is unique. Yeah. And the way their interests, their passion lies, I think that is where the parents' role would be like identify and help them to nurture it.
Yeah.
Most of the times, recently we have been hearing this, you know, that there are some students, they complete their engineering. And then they realize, no, this is not my calling. My calling
many,
is something.
I've known so many in the field of arts. Half the RJs are engineers. Half many of the actors are engineers.
Yes.
Directors are engineers. Yeah.
So I think the biggest shift, ma'am, you're on mute, ma'am. Usha, ma'am. Ma'am, Usha, ma'am, you're on mute.
Sorry. I said all the parents who are actually listening to us, they should tell the children, just pursue whatever you want to pursue. And what your heart tells, rather than forcing something on them, what they want them to become. So this is what, Ms. Kavita, this is what happens mostly. Mostly the parents just want them to, achieve their dreams rather than, you know, going behind. I mean, children want to achieve something else. Parents want to do something else with the children.
Yeah.
This is what I'm trying to say.
No, at least to be a very unsatisfying human being. Finally, what are you trying to make the child into? What are you trying to make it son or daughter into? Is to be a happy and content human being. Yes. I think if they pursue what they want, that's when they'll be happy. Sometimes the monetary, you know, might not be good enough, or maybe it's fantastic. Those things are secondary. First of all, I think in the soul and in your heart and in your creative mind, you should be happy. Only then you can do whatever
Ms. Kavita, if you want to become a film director or they want to pursue something very creative like this, so what is the kind of subject options they should do it after the grade 12?
No, there's certainly nothing as subject, I think. I would say they should read a lot, literature, a lot of literature. They should see a lot of films. They should see a lot of international films, not just Indian. They should see all kinds of cinema. They should see the theater. You know, there's everything. And I mean, also for me, for instance, even when I read the newspaper, that's when I got the idea for these folk singers, you know. There was a folk singer who had won an award, and she was trying to sell the award to get some rice for her family. So I said, it's such a pathetic stage, and she's the one who sings so well and so knows so many songs. And this is how we demean our artists, you know. They're also artists, not just actresses and heroine and film, you know. They're also fantastic artists. So I said, let me make a film on her. So it's like my inspiration has always been through life around me. So I think that's the very, people should take keen interest in nature, in life, in stories and happenings, you know. Because everybody, whether it's also big or star, it's small, from Abdul Kalam to your maid servant, everybody has a story of their own. And it can be uniquely told, you know.
True. Yeah. It all depends upon the passion.
Yes. And also, I feel that it's important to have life experiences rather than bookish knowledge or anything. A child should visit places, should travel. I today see like what I, the difference I see between my upbringing and several others who I come across is, like you said, academics, okay, they can take up academics as their priority if they are looking for something in the future. They're passionate about getting somewhere on in that line. And that's okay. But then once a child gets into like, say, eighth standard, and then they say, oh, you have to prepare for 10th. So don't come for weddings. Don't go for birthday parties. Don't meet people. Don't socialize. So you're becoming robotic. After some time, you may be a doctor, but you don't have basic communication skills. You don't know how to talk to your own patient. You don't know how to get the person's problem out of him. So having a certificate is important, but being a human is much more important than that, because that is what is going to connect you to anybody in any field. So no matter what you're looking at in becoming in your future, always focus on life experiences, travel, meet people, it may be the youngest kid in the vicinity or your family, socialize, meet people, because every person is worth writing up or where you're going. You should always focus on going to places and collecting a lot of life memories and life experiences.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's rightly put up. And what I can conclude from, you know, both of you have mentioned that let them try, let them have trial and errors in the school level itself. Like might be a child who is in grade 3 comes up and says that, no, I'm more interested with robotics. By the time the child reaches grade 5 says that, no, I'm no more interested over here. Can I sit and make jams and pickles? Because that's what I want to create. That's what is my calling, entrepreneurship. That is where it is coming from. So I think do it here. You know, do your mistakes, whatever you want to learn, do it here rather than waiting that I'll reach my college. I'll think then, once I complete my graduation, and then I'll think what I should pursue after that. Mm-hmm. So I think the school year itself, we have to take, and as a school, I mean, being educators, our role would be more that our environment has to be so feasible that the child is comfortable coming up and saying that, okay, I need to stop this year. I want to try something else from today. So that's where I think the parents and the school has to play a major role over here. So now coming back again to Kavita ma'am. Now I was asking that while Usha ma'am was reading your profile, she did mention that there is a kind of a resort that you have built, which is, you know, giving us a knowledge about, especially for the kids, you have built this resort, which is all about village life, the lifestyle, yeah, the skills, yeah, and all. Yeah. So what, what exactly it is and how does it work for the students? I mean,
this was basically started off as an inspiration from seeing children around me. Because it, as you know, everybody's in there, stuck their nose in their iPads or phones all the time. And kids are really not going out and playing like we used to, or have the innocent fun, you know. It's all been very technological fun and technological, you know, they spend a lot of time like this. So I decided, why not we make, you know, children play and really know their roots with playing like village games. So it was very important because half of the children are urban children, don't know any of these village games, which are very good for mental and physical coordination as well. You know? Gives them a lot of intelligence, facility, the whole movement, flexibility, everything is there, because most children nowadays, they don't know, half of them, when they're very small, they don't know where the peanuts are grown, they don't know if it comes in the tree or under the ground, and
absolutely,
simple things like that. And it's very important for children to be in vibe with the nature, I think that's very important. So that's Absolutely. One concept which I had. And a lot of schools, about 300 international and national schools have come to us. And it's been going on well, except this last 1 year because of the pandemic, as you know.
Usha ma'am also wanted, I mean, this year that, you know, we make the students visit the Gramin resort. Yeah. But due to the pandemic, we had to actually take a call that might be, I mean, once the vaccination
Things get back to normal. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, we will definitely. Yeah. We will definitely. Yeah. Esther, coming back to you, while I was, you know, reading through your profile and everything, I saw that at the age of 14, you were doing an activity that you were raising funds. For medical camps and all. So how did it come to you? Like, how did you, I mean, at the age of 14, generally, you know, kids are like, okay, let me think what I want to. But raising funds, I mean, for the community, how this idea came to you and how did you actually work for it?
The thing was, I have always, even now, like studies-wise, I chose to take up MA in political science. So there has always been this inclination towards wanting to do something in the society, to bring some change. And there has always been this, this constant feeling for various reasons. Like there might be, if I see someone poor, if I see a beggar who is not being able to afford food, if I see that they don't get what they deserve or they don't get equal opportunities, I see children not getting equal opportunities. So even in school back then, somehow I always had this inclination because of my upbringing, be it my parents and be it my way of looking at things. I always felt that certain things had to be addressed or needed help. So as I grew, music is always my love. Even now it's my first love. So I always wanted to do something in music. When I composed my first few songs and I wanted to come up with a musical show, my mother was very happy to see that I had started composing my own songs, and she definitely wanted to support me in that direction. But now the thing was, they did not want me to grow loving making money out of something I love. Like they wanted to learn to love my passion and learn to love my my talent and the process of becoming an artist rather than wanting to do something for money. So she said, okay, I would love for you to have a show of your own, but then you should choose a cause. Like, don't simply do saying that, okay, you want to do a show and make money out of it. No, your intention should be you want to do something good and be good at it. So now the question was, what intention and what to find? Like, what should be the actual cause to put this show? And at that time, we came across, we were looking for the right reason, for the right cause to put the show up on. And then we came across this particular cause wherein the diocese was looking for a trust to provide subsidies and financial assistance to so many cancer patients and patients with the people with the severe diseases who couldn't afford for treatments for all these diseases that they had. I mean, they were suffering from. So that sounded like a very good cause. And we said, okay, then maybe we could be the first check of this trust and, you know, support them. Maybe whatever financial gains we get from this show could be directed towards this cause. And we took it up and we spoke to the Bishop of Mangalore, and he was more than happy to collaborate with us. And it just worked out that way. For me, at the age of 14, to have come up with such a thing was plainly because of my parents and my mother and her guidance and her upbringing, is what I can say. Because like you said, at teenage, you don't really come up with, you will want to do certain things, but you'll not know how to get them Absolutely. Done. So at this time, you definitely need a lot of guidance and channelizing from mothers, especially, Absolutely. I can say, because mothers are the closest to their children. So yeah, there's no better channel than a mother.
Yes. And I think, I mean, somewhere, I mean, again, we have spoken to the same part, like even Kavita ma'am was saying that when you talk about, you know, kids who are growing up in metropolitan cities, you know, they are far from the, I won't say the village life, but that is actually the life skill, which every one of us should be knowing it. I mean, a kid right now, I mean, at the Dean School Bangalore and at the Bangalore
basic,
we have kids at a very early age, right from, you know, a toddler age, when they enter the school, we engage them with organic farming. It can be anything, like right from methi seeds to mustard seeds that they put, but they have to take care of it. So I think these are the must, it should be not a part of your curriculum, but that should be your curriculum. That should be the way of, you know, learning inside the school. And that is what I said, even you have mentioned, that music was your passion and that's where, you know, it took you. It made you think beyond that, okay, what after music? Yes. And this all connects that what exactly, when you are giving a right environment to a child, the child knows that, okay, this is what is my interest area, and they take it forward from there. Then that's beautifully you have put up. And also one thing that I can put up, that raising funds, it should be a part of all the school projects. When we talk about, you know, we talk about so many homeworks and assignments and all. In fact, we can take it up in the other manner. Let the kids, you know, get engaged in this kind of activity. So many skills they will be learning from this. Your communication skill, presentation skill, strategically thinking, planning. These are the skills which they will, I mean, get from all this activity. So I think fundraising, even, I mean, in our previous few brewing chats with various celebrities and all, we were discussing the same, that, you know, doing the work for the community shouldn't happen when they reach their college or might be their higher study level. But right, I mean, when Esther started at the teen age, there itself it should start. And the school should be supporting such kind of activity.
Yeah, because eventually, as they grow up, the world, the society, the mindset is such that everything goes towards scope. It is named scope, but scope indirectly means how much money you're going to make out of it. If I become an engineer, or if I become a whatever, okay, how much is it going to pay me? What is the placement? What is the salary? What is the package? So the constant, the success is directly connected, directly gauged based on how much money that particular job or that particular course is going to get you at the end of the day. But that is not
one
what
more
it is.
Thing. Yeah, Manju, one more thing.
Not equal to the money you make.
Yes. That's correct. Yeah. And as the
one more thing, Manju,
Kavita and Esther speak, I just want to interfere in between and interrupt in between. Parents who are listening to us and people who are listening to us, people who are chatting here, kindly note. Anyway, continue, Manju.
Yeah, so Kavita, ma'am, you wanted to add something to what
Esther said. Wanted to add when she was talking about how she raised funds. Esther was talking about this one more basic thing all schools can start, actually, is the idea of sharing. Because as you know, as the child grows up, from the tricycle to bicycle to everything, from toys, books, everything is thrown out. That's one thing they can bring to the school and share it or give it away to a lesser endowed kid. So that way it's very important that you learn the idea of sharing and caring. It's very important, I think. That would be a complete thing.
Thinking about the
schools, all the schools, you know, that gives the idea of a sense of belonging. When you go to a poorer school, maybe a government school or something, will you give away your toys and your books? So it can be a one-day outing for them. And imagine a child which will be so happy and receiving things, which are sometimes completely intact, you know, toys which are intact,
Absolutely.
Clothes which are intact. We're just throwing it away. We just become becoming an urban city of waste.
Yeah.
You know, so that's important, I think. So you can include that in your syllabus if you want to.
Also, this also used to be a basic life. This is to be a basic life, a part of people's life back then, because there were too many children, like there were 5-6 children
Absolutely.
In a household.
Yeah.
Today,
I mean, I remember
two,
wearing
so
my sister's hand-me-downs.
Of worrying about the other.
Yeah, I remember wearing my sister's hand-me-down,
so
and always they would stitch 4 inches long skirts. So as we grow taller, the tuck would keep coming down. So we were a sense of where, I mean, that was in a way, it was bad also in the way. We were, it's not a generation of wasting people.
Yes.
That was important, I think,
And also we would understand other, we understand other people's problems. We think for the other. Otherwise, we grow up thinking just about ourselves.
Yes.
me, what will I be, what will I,
Selfish society.
Absolutely. I think that's where it is very important that when we talk about, we are talking about empathy, we talk about how a child should be compassionate. And these all things, you can't teach them. You actually, you have to create an environment where these, skills, or I must say, these are the values which they will be taking from that environment, rather than telling them that you have to learn this. You can't teach moral values.
Yeah.
You can't teach empathy. You can't teach how to be compassionate, how to respect each other. It's very important that you build an environment wherein they take it from that environment. And of course, being the adults in their environment, your teachers, parents, we have to also follow the same thing, so that when they are looking up to you, they know that, okay, this is what I can take and I can take it forward from here. So that's very important. And that was very wonderful. Now, coming back to the question, I mean, you all have, you know, come across a long journey in with your passion and your interest areas. So were there any point which challenged you? I won't say that it was like a kind of failure and all, but a kind of challenging moment where you questioned and introspective. You said that, no, this is where I need to sit back, think about it, and take a step forward. So was there any point, like any point in your entire journey?
Esther can go for it. I'll talk later. She's young, so she can talk.
For me, I think that comes every second.
Yeah.
No, for me, it's like such points keep coming every now and then. I think every second day there's a challenge. Because today the world is, even right now, like as we are on this Zoom call, there are people trying to, you know, you're constantly being brought down in various ways. There's like a whole, there is an ocean of people, you know, cheering for you and wanting for you to, rooting for you. They want you to get somewhere. And then there is a whole lot of people and incidents and, you know, agencies trying to bring you down and pull you down and, you know, put, you know, a big stone on all the castle of your hard work and stuff like that. So every second day there is challenge. There is challenge in terms of what I just spoke. There is challenge in terms of wanting to do better. Like you don't want to do monotonous stuff. You want to do something new. You want to reinvent yourself, represent yourself. After a point, it's you cannot just keep being the same person and keep doing the same thing. So breaking your own previous self and building a new you. So these are the challenges which keep coming, and you just have to sit back and think, am I doing the right thing? Will this be a good idea? Should I be doing this? Will it be received? What should I say, or how should I put it? All these things keep coming. But I think that is what makes you, I mean, that is what keeps us going. If once we have achieved something and then say, okay, this is it, then just sit back and say, I've done it, I've reached there, it's over. Then there is nothing to look forward to. There is nothing to work towards. So I think every morning is a challenge. Waking up every morning and to do something you haven't done yesterday is a challenge.
And wanting to face the world. Being resilient and, you know, understanding that, you know, these are constructive criticism. We can mention it in that way. These are very constructive. And like I said, it gives you a new way of thinking, a new outlook, I must say, rather than, you know, you taking it,
yes,
like...
It makes you stronger. It's like there's a song that goes, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So if it doesn't kill you, then it will definitely make you stronger, sharper, harder.
Yes.
So it is the journey itself is preparing you for the destination. I mean, eventually we still don't know. This is still a part of the journey. It's not that we have reached somewhere. Okay, there's a particular level and you have reached there and that's it. Right. It's not like that. It's an ongoing process and it's a journey. We are just going on and on and on. And as we are going, we're preparing for the next level. And the previous level, the difficulties, the challenges, the questions, the doubts is what you require to become the one that you should be for next level.
Right.
So absolutely. So it's all a process. It's like it's an ongoing thing.
Kavita ma'am, your thoughts to it?
Yeah, being in the field of arts, I think, is always a challenge for both men and women, and especially for women. As you know, there are hardly any women directors in the whole world. Very few of them are there. And nowadays, they're doing a lot of good work. And, you know, I mean, being noticed, and a lot more women are coming in. But otherwise, it's been it's a challenge constantly. But it's also exciting every day. As I said, every day, it's like, we are, you know, painting a new canvas every day. So it's beautiful. But at the same time, the challenges are in terms of money, in terms of agreement, in terms of talking to people. You know, whether it will happen at all, you have a story, whether the story will ever see, you know, to convert it to celluloid. So these are the doubts. And every child will go through, not only if you're in films, but in any field, you will have challenges. You will be put down many times. But at the same time, it's important to know what your dreams are and you know your self-worth, I think. Only then you can go ahead. You know, because whoever puts you down doesn't matter. If you know your dreams and you yourself, what you're thinking of, you're planning, if your self-worth is good, you can achieve anything in the world, I think.
Absolutely. Yeah. Very true. Yeah. Usha ma'am.
Fantastic. No, I'm saying she's put in a nutshell. She's put in a very nice way, saying what it was possible could be achieved if you are having that passion and that drive.
Yeah.
That's what she means by that.
Yeah.
Yes, Esther.
Yes, so I think, I mean, now since we are towards the end of the show, one suggestion or one kind of, you know, takeaway that can be from each one of you for the audience as well as for yourself.
Just the kind of a thing to be summarizing it, you know, because we named it as Brewing Chat with Entrepreneurs, and probably, you know, a kind of an inspiration, a quote or a kind of thing which they can take home and say, okay, or they can mull over it and say, this is what we can do in life. Something like that, Esther.
Esther.
I think I can say is see. people, for children, from a very young age, be it a male or a female, It is a tendency of the society, or sometimes it begins from the parents, actually. We say society, but for children, society begins from home. So from the beginning, people tend to label children. They say, oh, my child is lazy, or my child is dull, my child is smart, my child is active. So there will be many labels. By the time a child has gained complete conscience and understood what he or she or who he or she is, they have already grown up believing in all those labels that they have been receiving from their closest people, from the people who have given them birth, from the people who are raising them, from the people around them, and the classmates and the teachers. Everybody says, oh, you are a dull student, you're a smart kid, oh, he's an all-rounder, and all these things. But what they should grow up believing is these labels don't define them. It is just an opinion of people about them. What defines them is what they believe they are and who they think they are. Is what matters the most, not what people, because it just gets bigger with age and time. Like when you grow older, when you get the bigger the field, the bigger the tags and the heavier the load of tag. Mm-hmm. So for children, and I think it's going to play a very big role in entrepreneurship, because when you're like how Kavita ma'am said that you will be brought down. No doubt you will fall down. Like if the bigger the entrepreneur you are, the bigger the falls you will have. So falling down and being tagged and being dragged down is the most silliest of things that's going to happen to you. Like that is not even like a serious thing that you're going to feel bad about. So children should grow up being okay with failures, being okay with being wrong. Like I have seen children getting very offended when they are called out as wrong out of two children, and they say, oh, you did it wrong, or you did it less better than the other person. They take it very offensively. They don't have the heart. Also because I see, maybe because they're one and two children, they don't know to take rejection. They don't know to take failures. So children should grow up learning to accept opinions of other people while knowing that that is not what they completely are. They are much more than those labels.
True.
And at the same time, it is okay to not be perfect. It is okay to not be like the other person. Okay to lose. It's okay to be you is what they should grow up believing. And as and when they grow, if that is the foundation and if that is how their thought process, the mindset is once set, then everything will fall in place, because mind defines the whole person. So how they think, how they see things, how they pursue things is what is going to define a human, be it a girl or a boy. So we should focus more on raising such people who believe in themselves and not on people's opinion about them, and people who are okay with being human and being imperfect and being themselves.
Absolutely. Kavita ma'am.
Yeah, being a girl's child today,
and a good conclusion.
Yeah, yes. Being a girl child day today, I assume a lot more parents are watching this than children or students, I would assume, and I would request all the parents to really re-look into how they look into it. They have two children, one boy and one girl. Re-look into how you're treating them. Are you treating them equally? That's very important. Are you telling the boy, oh, it's okay to go out and play in the night, but you're telling the girl, don't go out, it's not safe? Or are you telling the boy, you better be careful and look out for this girl child and respect her? These are the things which has to be taught from day one, I think. Or even when you're however you're treating them, it should be equal, and you should learn, you should teach all the boys to respect women and take care of women. I think that's very important when today being a girl child, I think. That's one important. And stop comparing. I think the parents do that a lot. See, they keep comparing, your neighbors keep to your kids and everybody, they keep comparing, oh, she's better, he's better, or you're not good at this. That's something I think we have to as parents do is give them wings and teach them how to fly. The rest, they will do it. But keep them going, that's very important. So give them that faith and trust, they will do it. They will make dreams come true, make your dreams, their dreams come true. So it's very important. It's more how we hone the children from, you can't suddenly wake up and when they're graduated and say, don't treat your wife like that. If they're beating the wife or something, you can't do that. It has to be instilled from day one, from their childhood, I think. So that's the point I would like to make and request all the parents here.
Absolutely. Usha ma'am,
here Priyanka Singh has joined us today. So Priyanka, you can just say hi and bye to all of them. Just join.
So hi all, and good evening, and thank you so much, first of all, for coming here and giving your suggestions, your ideas, because we as a women, we always look other women to give a suggestion how best we can do. And here we are with the wonderful ladies like you too. So thank you so much from Green School Bangalore. that you have selected us to give that opportunity. We are really pleased to have such strong women with us today. Yes, Usha ma'am.
Yes, thank you so much. I think it's
thank you, Priyanka. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. I was listening everything and very pleased and blessed to hear you today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me on this platform. It was a pleasure. It was a pleasure being a part of this.
Same here. Oh, it was a pleasure to have both of you on the show. And it was a great show, of course, in spite of a certain interruption with a kind of wave with people in between. Doesn't matter. Sometimes gets hacked. That's why Zoom, it's not very safe for children. We don't use Zoom for teaching kids. We use Microsoft for teaching kids. So that's what we do because it's much more safer. This is much more exposed to the different kind of all across the globe. So that Zoom has to take care of it, of course. Of course, it was a wonderful show. And Manju, over to you for concluding it.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Esther. And thank you so much, Kavita ma'am, for, you know, being so patient with all my questions continuously popping up, this, that and all. Probably I made you feel nostalgic also, taking you back to your childhood journey. But thank you so much for, you know, you have given us a lot of insight, not only to us, but to the parents and to the entire student community who is listening out over there, that dreams are dreams, but don't believe that, you know, okay, fine, I'm not getting a chance right now, so later on also I should quit it. Dreams are dreams. You should dream and you should look forward to it. Work hard. That is what you both have mentioned. We would love to have you in our campus as soon as the kids are back. We are missing our kids, but as soon as they are back, please do visit the Bangalore School and the Green School Bangalore. We would love to have you in our campus.
Absolutely. Anytime. Thank you, Manju. Thank you, Usha. Thank you.
Thank you so definitely, much.
Lovely meeting you, Esther. Bye.
Yeah, definitely, Miss Kavita, we'd like
same
to
here,
for, visit your Grameen
camp,
whatever it is.
Yeah.
We'd like to visit.
Soon, that. Very soon. I look forward to hosting you.
Yes. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Have a great evening. Thank you, Manju and Usha. It was nice talking to you.
Bye.
Yeah, bye-bye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Kavita, ma'am. Bye-bye. Have a great evening.
Same here. Have a great evening.